Well, for me, when the pandemic hit, I was still in my university in the Philippines doing my internship near a hospital. And I had 2 more months left until I would graduate. So when the pandemic hit, it didn't. My initial thought wasn't to come back to Yellowknife. Actually, I was. The school told me we could finish, you just gotta give it a bit more time. You know, when they said, COVID would only last 2 weeks at most or whatever, and it ended up being like a whole year. But when it hit, I had to pretty much isolate myself for like 2 months or so, stuck in one, my little apartment where I didn't really have anyone to talk to or anything. So when it hit, I didn't go back to Yellowknife. That wasn't what I did next. I actually had to wait until the school would tell me what was going on next. So obviously, I was very disappointed in that. I only had 2 more months until, and then I would have graduated, but then it prolonged to like 4 months, and still we had no word if we would go back to school or not. So during that time, I was pretty down about everything.
When the pandemic first hit and I came back to Yellowknife, at first I was really disappointed because I had other plans. I was away at university at Andrews University, and I wasn't yet done my degree. The year was cut short, and it kind of felt to me like going back in time to go back to Yellowknife, that place where I grew up. And so I was pretty disappointed at first, and especially because I had these other plans that I was going to do my internship internationally and perhaps even stay longer and continue doing mission work. And that's what was really on my mind, and that had been motivating me for the past year in my degree. And so for all of that to fall apart when the pandemic hit was really disappointing.
When the pandemic hit and I first came to Yellowknife, me and my wife came together and we were excited but also nervous as well. We were excited because it was a new adventure. We came from Australia and we were kind of wanting to try out Canada for a while. And COVID, believe it or not, but it actually worked in our favor to allow us to come over here. It closed some doors for us in Australia, and it opened some doors for us to come to Yellowknife. So that was exciting. We were going back to my wife's family and have that support. And it was also nerve-wracking as well because there wasn't too many people that we knew that was sort of our age group. We had quite a lot of friends back in Australia. And so we were saying goodbye to a lot of them, which was a bit nerve-wracking, and also finishing uni and work in Australia for both of us, and coming to something that we didn't really know what we were doing career-wise. So that was a bit nerve-wracking. So, yeah.
Well, one thing I would say was the fact that I did get to come back here. There was a point where I kind of gave up and was like, all right, let me just go back home to Yellowknife because there's nothing waiting for me in the Philippines anymore because, the school wasn't getting back to us. So I booked a flight. It was going to happen in like about two, like a month. And I was preparing to go back home when, like 2 weeks before the flight, the school got back to us and said, hey, you can finish. And I was like, what? I just got my flight. I'm ready to go home. Why are you telling me this now, right? Like, I was so prepared to come back because I needed a break from the break I was taking, from the pandemic. But, I prayed about it because already the flight was already really difficult at that time. The borders were up. You didn't really know for sure if you need extra things, your flight would get canceled. There's a lot of problems that were going on, and it seemed like if I left then, I would be fine. So I was contemplating and just praying, like, should I just go or should I stay and finish? And I ended up choosing to stay. And that in itself was a blessing because God helped me through the rest of my academic period, and I was able to finish. And once I was able to finish, he also set up a flight for me again. So again, even though I didn't go at the time where I thought was best for me, he still prepared a time that would let me finish my schooling and at the same time be back home with all my family and all the back with the church and back with the things I'm familiar with.
For me, it's been probably the family and the friendships that I've been able to form here. As I mentioned before, my wife's family was here, her immediate family, and her brother was overseas, and Trista was overseas as well. So it sort of, COVID sort of gave the opportunity for her family to come back together, and that's been a huge blessing. So yeah, it was really a blessing because my wife's family was able to come back together. We're sort of all over the world before COVID, before the pandemic, and the pandemic, yeah, sort of allowed her family to come together, and that's been a huge blessing for us to just spend a lot of time together, especially because me and my wife have recently had a new baby, our first baby. And so it's been a huge help just to have that support around as well. And another thing has been just the friendship. There's been a number of people that have had to come home because of the pandemic, and it's created a sweet, powerful little small group that we have, that we're similar interests, similar spiritually on fire, on with God, and we just sort of enjoy each other's fellowship and just enjoy studying the Bible and hanging out with each other. And we wouldn't have, that group wouldn't have formed if it wasn't for the pandemic. So that's been a huge blessing as well.
Some positive ways that I've seen God working in my life since I got back. God just really helped me understand this idea that this message kind of went through my mind. I either serve God here or nowhere. And for me, I was like thinking about a place, serving God in a place. I had a place I wanted to be, and it wasn't this place. That's where I wanted to serve God, not here. So this phrase, it's got to be here or nowhere, really came into my mind, because I was thinking, if my wanting to serve God and worship Him with my life is dependent on a place, it's not genuine. So I have to worship Him here and find mission here as well. So coming back to the church that I grew up in, having just been in a university setting, you know, worship is very dynamic and there's a lot of young people involved. And I was thinking, it's going to be difficult for me to go back to my church where I know there's not a lot of young people, and it's definitely a very different vibe than what I had been in for the past several years. But I remember something that my dad said to me when I was younger was, if there's something you want to see changed in the church, you have to do it. You have to take the initiative and do it. Don't wait for someone else to do it. I think that's a really important message for young people of our time. If we want to see changes in the church, why are we waiting for the generation above to do it for us, when we know, you know, maybe even better what is relevant in our day and what people of our age are looking for? So we have an opportunity to make that influence. So some things that really God put on my heart was that we need to build community among the other young adults, because we have many young adults, kind of some of them on the fringes of the church, here once in a while, some of them here often. And so we wanted to create a group where we could meet together and encourage each other. And so one of our young adult members, two of them, I guess, Matt and Trista, opened up their home so that we could have a midweek meeting, and that really grew our bond a lot together as a group. We would study the Bible, we would always have snacks, we would play games, we had celebrations for like baby showers and for Christmas, and we sang karaoke on New Year's, and those kind of things already just, they drew us together so much and made this kind of community that we wanted to invite more people into, which was really important for us. Then another thing that's important to me is music. I love music, and there's so many talented musicians in our church and people who just need to be wrangled and brought together. And so that's what we've been working on, creating a worship band that can build some chemistry. And it's really been a blessing to get out of our comfort zone. Even at one point, our piano player left, and then I had to step in as just the next person in the church who knew something about piano but not very much, and that also helped me to grow as a musician. So there's been like a lot of learning and growth opportunities.
For me, I would say that my my mind would be renewed every time I'm with the young adults and talking about God and just like Bible study with them, because we always have really good discussions and new things that we discover from each other. And it's like, because back in the Philippines when I was staying there, we had our normal discussions and stuff, but it was different when I got back here because the perspective is totally different. And I learned a lot from the other youth people in our group. And it's just very refreshing to see their side and actually discover like new things about the Bible, new things about God. And like, it really renews your spirit when you realize, hey, there's so much more I need to know. And these things I'm learning is very uplifting to me. And it's just a lot of fun when you're in the spirit with a group of people. So yeah, for me, it would be a renewing whenever I'm with that group and with God in them.
Just with the young adult small group that we've been having, we would hang out quite often on the weekend, and we'd also have a Bible study every Wednesdays. And that was just sort of a weekly reminder that sort of what the Christian life is to be all about. And it's with studying God's word, it's praying together, and also just trying to do mission work and trying to bless others and bring others into the group. So I feel like God's really used that group to help me see the importance of what life is all about.
It's also been great to see other people in the church step up and make a difference in the area that interests them and that they feel passionate about. And one of the other young adults, she took on some events for health ministry and had different cooking events and had been recommending books and having workout classes. And that's another thing that built our church together. So it's really inspiring to see other people going and doing that talent that God created in them. We also found it really important to start working with the children, and specifically the girls, because I didn't want to deal with the boys. Okay, we shouldn't put that in there, but it's too much. So, okay, let me go back. One thing that we wanted to start doing since our young adults group was growing together was to also extend that to the children in our church and the youth. And so we realized that we could have an impact on the younger people of the church. We also want to extend God's love in that direction. Yeah, so we had some parties.
Welcome to another program. This is Conference Happenings with Debbie. And you know, I always like to do some of the different departments in the conference office. And today I have somebody with me that you'll all recognize. And I think it will be a fun time to listen. Dr. Lyle Notice is with me.
What's up?
Hey, come on, let's have some energy here. I'm not the youth, you're the youth. You do the youth department at the Alberta Conference, is that correct?
Yes, that is correct, yeah.
And I know that you do all sorts of things with youth, but I'm sitting here at the Lacombe Skate Park. Why?
This is where, this is like my favorite sort of pastime activity. This is what I do in my spare time, my on time, my off time. This is where I hang out a lot with young people.
Is it a de-stressing time too?
Yeah, you know, to be on the board and just kind of flow the park and, you know, be in community with this younger demographic, the energy that they bring. Mm-hmm. Like this is one of the favorite places for me to be.
Well, it is beautiful here. It's green. I've never been here before. I mean, I'm not a skateboard person, so you know, what can I say? I know that you have a couple of small children.
Yes.
Do they skateboard with you?
Yeah, actually they do. I started to teach Marlo 2 years ago. She's four now. So when she was two, she was out here just kind of like kneeboarding and just kind of try to find her balance. And so my son Cairo, who's two, I just started him. He's just got his first setup, his first deck,
oh
DGK board, you know, some Spitfire wheels. Like he's getting the hang of it too. Like, it's funny how kids just naturally get things, even at two, you know?
You have to start young.
Yes,
I think so. I think that's it. When did you start skateboarding?
I started skateboarding in my teens, around 8. And then I got into basketball. And then I got back into it around 15. And then I picked it up after so many years, actually when I moved here to be associate youth director in 2012, when the park opened up. So I've been skating here since 2012.
You just kind of could move in.
I might as well. I might as well sleep. Actually, yesterday I was here with a homie until like 11:30 p.m.
Oh, my.
We're just talking about life and just, it's definitely a vibe. It's definitely a place where you can come and interact and just talk and just be, you know?
Well, a little later, I'm going to ask you to show us some of your moves. Is that okay?
Yeah, I'll flow the park, the bowl, I'll drop in, flow the bowl a bit, show you.
This is lingo that I'm not used to, but you know, that's okay. I know what it means.
I actually have an extra deck here. If you want to learn, I could definitely teach you.
Let's think about it for a minute.
But you gotta have the right shoes though. I don't know if those are gonna work.
I don't think they will, but maybe you can show me at least how to balance or stand on it without falling down.
Deal, we'll do that.
Never too late to try.
It's never too late.
Okay, well, now let's get down to what happens in the youth department. Because that's a good thing for you to do, because there is youth that come out here all the time. And you're youthful and you're into that. So it's a good place to witness. I'm sure of it.
It's awesome. That's where I met a good buddy of mine, Jack, Monday, and helped him to sort of start his own clothing line and business. But it was at the skate park. And then what was cool was, at the time, I remember Eddie Hippolyte, he was doing a youth rally at Foothills. And so I invited Jack. And yes. To this day, he still continues to connect with Eddie Hippolyte. Had an impact on him, you know?
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you have got a DMin now, which means you're a doctor, from Andrews University Seminary, right?
That's correct, yes.
What is that in?
I have a Doctor of Ministry in Urban Ministry.
Which is part of this.
Which is this. Which exactly, it connects. You know, for my project, I was looking at how do I create a space for postmoderns, for young adults, for youth, those who have sort of left the church, who are unchurched, who are secular. Could I create a small group that would help them throughout their life, teach life skills, accountability, you know, spiritual empowerment. And it was awesome. So I did that for a period of from September to December. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to test if it would have an impact on their lives. Would they be more interested in faith? Would they be more connected to the church? Would they be involved in youth ministry, in urban ministry? And it was awesome. With 12 young adults, we met once a week for about 4 months, and it was the most powerful experience in life.
So at least if they don't belong to a church now, they have been churched and they know Jesus.
Exactly.
Which is probably the most important part.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Now, I understand though that you're also doing a PhD.
Yes. Oh. I started a PhD, a doctor of philosophy of religion. But I'm doing church and society, and I'm looking specifically at the Alberta Conference and race relations.
Oh.
And so I know that there are many different churches according to culture and race.
Yes. Yes.
And so I'm trying to figure out how do we create more of a diversified church gatherings where all races are able to sort of worship together.
Where we can come together.
Yeah.
And that's what our camp meeting is all about. Stronger together.
Stronger together.
Perfect. Perfect. But you know, this last year we've had a, not a setback, but a different kind of youth experience in your department. What kind of things were impacted with your programming and things?
Yeah. I mean, it's definitely been different. You know, much of youth ministry involves being in the presence of young people.
Yes.
On a daily basis. You're with them. And COVID definitely separated me from youth and youth programming, you know, being at Foothills, doing youth rallies, going on mission trips, you know, it's been definitely a different way of life. And so I've had to pivot and do things virtually.
Right.
And one of the things that I've sort of come up with at the start of COVID, a really great friend of mine, Namiko, who's my cameraman and sort of producer, we came up with this idea called Everything is Spiritual. And so we would make short videos, like literally 1 to 2, 3 minutes, mm-hmm. on like just random things in life. Like one time I did one on a sponge and the spiritual sort of connections of sponge and life.
The shoebox, I like.
Yeah, I did one on shoes.
Yes.
You know, kicks, you know,
yeah,
shoes.
Yeah, yeah.
I did one on kombucha.
Yeah.
But just taking random things in life and seeing the spiritual perspective. And so that was one thing I've done. Creating content, spiritual content for young people.
And the shorter, almost the better sometimes. I know I looked forward to every Friday night because I would listen and it was always a message, always.
Yeah, yeah, a lot of people, they shared it with their friends who weren't Christian, their co-workers, and they said it was just perfect.
The right amount of time.
I think with this demographic, right, they want not long. I heard it said they want snackable size content. They don't want a
perfect.
Full meal, you know? And so...
I agree.
Yeah,
I agree. Snacks are great.
Eat your snacks.
So that leads me into some of the different kinds of programs you did. And I know you've done a lot, especially on Sabbath, mm-hmm. because I might not be youth age anymore, but I do like to listen and I like to know what's going on. And so what are some of the Sabbath things that you did?
Right. So I still wanted to provide programming, but I didn't just want to take what I did physically and then do the same thing online. The youth, they just weren't feeling that. And so what I did was I created something called Youth Empowerment Weekends. And it was more about a dialogue. I used Zoom and then streamed it to Facebook. But for instance, some topics were mental health, mm-hmm. Abuse. Another one that I did that the kids really loved was on entrepreneurship, where I invited a startup founder, to come in and share his experience on he's starting an app and creating a phone service. And it was, I actually sort of geared that one to the older sort of senior youth. But what happened was the adventure kids somehow gravitated and it kind of became about them. They were just so interested in wanting to create and innovate. And I got calls afterwards, and it was just powerful to see that even at that age, their young minds, they were thinking, you know, how can I create a business idea, you know, at 4 years old, at 5 years old, you know?
But that's what's going on now. You know, I skipped that one because I thought I'm too old to innovate and all entrepreneur and all that. So I skipped that one. But I can see that the younger generation are doing that. They just do that. They don't have the regular kind of jobs that some of us older ones do.
Right.
So I understand where he was coming from, but I was surprised at the age group that listened.
Well, you know, it's also said that, you know, the next sort of Fortune 500 company is going to come from a kid who's coding in their bedroom, you know, who's doing vlogging, you know, who's doing YouTube videos, content creation. And so what I wanted to do was sort of harness that creativity and say, listen, young people, you can do amazing things right now, even in COVID.
Yeah. So I know you did one on abuse, and that was a very good one. It was in conjunction with Elise from the Berman University Success Center.
Yeah.
And I know that she's doing actually 4 days of a seminar. So everybody probably, if you haven't, go back and look at our website and find those seminars because they were very, very good.
Yeah, it was powerful. You know, there's a lot of young people who are hurting throughout this time. And, you know, we wanted to sort of send the message that, you know, silence is violence. You know, there's a lot of people who have been abused or victimized and they're suffering in silence. And it's okay to speak about it. It's okay to talk about it and get help. And we wanted to provide support for victims.
It's interesting because the younger generation, I think, are better at going back and looking at themselves and trying to get the help, whereas maybe my generation still kept it quiet
didn't.
And maybe that's detrimental to my generation and, you know, somewhere in there. But I, that was a very well thought and well received, I know. Yeah. The mental health one, what was that one about?
Oh, that was awesome. We had Pastor Patrick Jacques, who's finishing up his doctorate in clinical psych through Fuller. And he provided, you know, the message really was this. Young Timothy had problems, according to scholars, with anxiety. But yet Paul still recognized his call and empowered him. And so Pastor Jacques was saying, young people, it's not about you being perfectly mentally okay. That does not discredit you from being involved in ministry. You can have issues and challenges, mental health issues, and God can still choose you and use you. And so it was just powerful. And to talk openly about, you know, being called by God, still being a spiritual leader, and still suffering with mental health and that journey.
I think that's apparent, and more apparent all the time, is that there is anxiety in any generation, and it just depends on how you deal with it.
Right, right.
You did some cultural ones. Mm-hmm. I know I listened to the one about the Asian culture.
Yes.
Because I lived in the Asian culture for 6 years, and so it really, really was interesting to me. It was just powerful for me. How did that one come about?
Well, I actually met Danny Penn, who is an advocate. She's an advocate, young adult leader. I met her on a panel last year during some of the social justice challenges that were taking place in the States. And it was awesome. I just knew that I needed to bring her mm-hmm. on. And so she talked about advocacy, activism, and allyship. And this idea of how we could support the Asian community through their challenges right now. And it was excellent. Excellent context. She gave some historical sort of information on her background mm-hmm. and the suffering that her family went mm-hmm. through. Mm-hmm. What was really cool was she was a refugee mm-hmm. coming into Toronto. And she said that she literally was raised within a church. Her family, her mom didn't have anywhere to go, so the church took her in. And so she was raised within the church, and it's just powerful to see how she's just this awesome voice for people being used by God. But, you know, her origin story comes straight out of a church building, you know.
Stronger together. It comes back to stronger together. I know you've done some other things through NAD, and you've been presenting some of the things that they have done. What have you been doing with that?
Yeah, what's cool is the other day I was asked to present on a church planting boot camp. And so shout out to Anthony Wagner Smith at the NAD Evangelism Institute. Last year, I should say previous to COVID, he invited me to be a part of a cohort of young sort of preachers who were thinking about planting churches. Mm-hmm. And so it was like a four weekend cohort, and you were taught about how to plant a church, how to cast the vision, given all the resources and the tools. And it was such a powerful, powerful experience for me because it gave me a different view of church planting. Hmm. And I was set to start a church plant here in Lacombe, right. One in Edmonton and one in Calgary. And because of COVID, obviously that sort of kind of got kiboshed, but they still asked me to share my story and my testimony. And so, yeah, the NAD has been asking me to share on church planting, also in the youth ministry department, continuing education, urban ministry. So I'm getting to employ some of the things I learned about over the years.
Well, you're not short of work, are you? Let's talk a little bit about the uniform ministries. I know you have somebody that's kind of taken over that for you because it's a huge thing all by itself.
Yes, yes, yes.
Who is it and what is she doing?
It is none other than Janet. Janeth has actually been working within the Division B
of camp meeting.
And so for several years. And so I thought she would be the awesome, just the best choice when it came to someone to lead Uniform Ministries. And so she is our coordinator right now for mm-hmm. Master Guides, Pathfinders, and Adventurers.
She was very, very into Adventurers when I first got to know her too.
Yes, she was also Alberta Conference Executive Coordinator for Adventures for many years. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and mm-hmm. she was doing an awesome job.
Well, you know, did they do the Pathfinder Camperee? That's always in May. Long weekend in May, it snows, it's always there. Did they do that?
Well, we did it, but it was virtual. Ah. And something what was really cool this year is typically it's an executive committee or the conference leadership that's helping to plan the programs. Mm-hmm. Well, earlier this year, we had winter retreat, which was virtual, and we heard from the young Pathfinders that they wanted to do it. They wanted to be the ones to lead and be involved. And we were blown away at some of the ideas that they had. So we said, okay, you know what? Instead of us planning it, we're going to allow the club directors and the Pathfinders to lead out and plan. And so they did that, and it was virtual. They did a week of prayer leading up to May long weekend mm-hmm. virtual campery, and it was awesome to see. Our young Pathfinders spoke all week, and the theme was fearless. And just to see that they were literally fearless. I think what I learned the most, Debbie, was that you sometimes underestimate these young mm-hmm. minds.
Leaders in action.
Oh,
and
man.
Leaders for the future.
They have so much potential, and we just need to give them the platform and the opportunity to lead.
So another thing that happened, and I know it's a Pathfinder thing, it was a Bible Bowl. Was that an NAD
yes.
or SDACC? Where did that come from?
Oh, man. So Bible Bowl has sort of been rebranded as the Pathfinder Bible Experience, but it's the same thing that you grew up on.
In Pathfinders.
And what was awesome was, would you believe this year, I think it was probably the first time in Alberta's conference history, we had two of our teams that made it to the finals, and the NAD finals.
Wow.
First place winners.
Wow.
Yeah, yeah.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
And it was all online.
It was all online. And, you know, it was definitely a learning curve for the team and the committee and all of the leaders and the clubs. But we did it. We pulled through. And it was awesome to see that, Bridgeland, Cimarron's, that was the club that took first place from our conference,
oh, wow.
as well as Airdrie, their team. So we had two clubs that placed first place at the North American Division Finals.
And that means next year when you do it, and we can travel. Those groups will have the most amazing time.
Yes, yes. And they were looking forward to traveling, but you know what? They're going to have to do a second peat and get there in the physical next year.
Well, you know, our time is running out, but I'm going to ask you if you have anything planned for this coming year.
Yeah, you know, things are still up in the air. We're about to open up, it seems. And mm-hmm. so if we do open up, we have something that I can't open the lid on
oh.
just yet.
oh!
But Elevate X, if anyone knows about
oh,
Elevate
yes.
X.
Yes, I was there, even if I'm not a youth.
Elevate X, I'll give you, remember Elevate X in Banff, that whole mountaintop experience? Something's coming.
Okay. Well, you know, it's always a pleasure. We could talk for hours, and I know that my time is not very long here. But thank you for being with me. Thank you for bringing me to the skateboard park or skate park or whatever it would be called.
Skate park.
skate park. And you know what? You're going to make me stand up on one of these, right?
Yeah, we've got to skate. We come
Even
on.
In these shoes. I mean, I'm not going to go too far. Like maybe 3 inches, but that's all. That's
we
all. About
we might have
my
to
limit.
Take those off. But
I can do it in bare feet. Never too late.
That's what they did back in the day, so.
Thank you again for being with me this year, and I pray that your department will thrive as it has in the past, and it will keep thriving, and being stronger together. Thank you. Well, you know, Lyle talked me into trying out this board. What's it called?
Skateboard.
A skateboard. I might be on the ground in a minute, but I'm going to try a couple of things, and don't laugh at me. I'm old, and this is a young person's sport. Okay.
You got to make sure that both, when you get on, both your feet are on the bolts, so you stand, you're standing shoulder length apart. Okay? Just make sure that...
I'm going to hang on. Is that okay? Because I think this is tippy.
There you go.
Good?
There you go.
Whoa! Oh, my word. This is very tippy, and it goes
fast. Kind of bend, too, like you're surfing.
Ooh, I can't surf either. Okay, you know what? I'm going to stay right here, and I'm going to stand with my feet on the ground, and I'm going to let Pastor Lyle show us how to do this.
Let's go flow the bowl. You should try that.
You want me to try that?
Yeah.
Why don't I just grab onto you and we'll go down together? We will go down together. Anyway, have a good time. Thank you for watching this impromptu lesson on a skateboard. Bye, Lyle.
Bye.
Speaker is Pastor Wayne Williams. As a young adult, Pastor Williams was impressed to enter into the ministry. He studied at Canadian University College, Oakwood College, and Northern Caribbean University, earning a BA in theology and religion. After serving as a pastor in the Ontario Conference, he obtained an MDiv and is currently completing a doctorate at Andrews University. Pastor Williams serves as an executive secretary, vice president of the administration of the Alberta Conference. Pastor Williams, his greatest earthly treasure is his family, his wife, and two children.
Isolated.
So expensive to travel.
Depression.
The darkness. We have so much darkness.
Substance abuse. The suicide rates are higher.
They become suspicious of visitors.
Just as they get involved, the people are gone.
In 1962, an Adventist pastor and his wife, James and Virginia Cooper, built a boat and sailed up the Mackenzie River, visiting different indigenous communities and sharing Adventist literature, exposing themselves to one of the most inhospitable places on the planet. The Northwest Territories has over 1 million square kilometers, 11 official languages, in 33 communities. For this is what the Lord has commanded us. I have made you a light for the Gentiles, that you may bring salvation to the ends of the earth.
I love the summers here because it's pretty well always dry. Lots of fishing, hiking.
24 hours of light. Actually quite a comfortable place to live.
The people are extremely warm, and maybe they're warm to compensate for the climate outside, but it's a very friendly, warm place to live.
We kind of get to make our own entertainment and our own fun, and so it provides a real community kind of feel. For the last 19 years, I've been a school counselor and more recently a school psychologist. The suicide rates are higher both in Northwest Territories and Nunavut than in other parts of Canada. Those issues are related to depression, substance abuse, and past trauma, and even trauma that's continuing to go on in people's lives. Many of the communities in the territories are very isolated. They're fly-in communities, not accessible by a road system. For most of the year, some of them have winter road systems. So it's very hard for those people to access services.
Things are spread out so much. It's so expensive to travel. I've been all in a few places like Cambridge Bay and Tuktoyaktuk, and oh, it's a great need here.
When my husband and I first moved to Yellowknife, I remember meeting in this church building with about 14 people each Sabbath. But now the church has grown to where we often have between 60 and 70 people meeting each Sabbath. Just that increase in number of people has really opened the door for a lot more programs that we're able to offer, a lot more outreach to the community. Four for Families is a program that was started by my husband, Blake. The emphasis was to provide activities and supports for families within the church and within the broader community, and offering different classes for ukulele lessons, vegetarian cooking, making photo books.
I am a hotelier, and I've had the distinct pleasure of living in many places around the world. One of the challenges that you will find in any remote community is that they become suspicious of visitors.
People got used to other denominations and things coming and going. And just as they get involved, the people are gone. And they're left again in the same situation as before.
So when somebody comes in for 2 months or worse, for 2 weeks, they tend not to have the impact that we are all looking for.
A very close friend of mine that I met back in the mines years ago, came to talk to him about Christ, and we discussed things for 6 years. Then he decided he wanted to be baptized. A bunch of us went from here to Fort Resolution and baptized him. Beautiful little town. It's right on the Great Slave Lake. It was actually a 7-hour drive. It's a town of maybe 400 people, mostly Aboriginal, but there are people in there from all over. That person has a real burning interest in evangelizing his town. So since then, the church body from here, we went there and followed up, and the people were very gracious to us.
It's important that we connect with locals and have locals bring you into the community. once this local takes you into the community, he or she will be putting their reputation on the line and said, yes, this is a friend that can be trusted. Friends will hang around. Friends don't just come in and disappear. Working with Vacation Bible School in the north, it's a breath of fresh air. You learn so much from the young people. I also get so excited when I see young people having fun in Jesus' name. In this one group, the Denny Nations, I pulled the coordinator aside and I said, I couldn't help but notice the excitement in your voice when I said, yes, you could come. And she says, oh, you know, you guys, over the years, you do such a great job with the children. They're excited about coming. They're learning things. And you're not being offensive. And we love it. If you take the time to look for negatives, you can find negatives. But I've also learned the true challenge about living in the North is how empowered you become to find solutions. I have the greatest pleasure working with the Pathfinders because I get to see all of the joy. Baking bread, and one of the Aboriginal children asked me, what does baking bread have to do with Christ? And we had a wonderful half an hour of conversation about the different times that Jesus referred to bread, how that the devil tempted Christ, that he made the stone into bread. But then we got into how we use different ingredients to make the bread, and a lot of those ingredients by themselves would not taste good, but when combined together carefully, it makes for a wonderful tasting bread. And the church is the same way. We have different personalities, different cultures, and they come together and God bless us and make us a wonderful church. The greatest sermon you can preach is the life you live. The more people we have to live it, the more effective our ministry is going to be.
What people need most is commitment.
It has to be somebody who is willing to dive in totally, be a part of the local culture.
Anything that builds relationships and connects with people lays the foundation for really great mission work.
We have seen great support pour out from all over North America, but we still need more help. God is calling you today. Will you pray? Will you give? Will you come?
So, Pastor Rudy, my girls really enjoyed your sermon last Saturday.
Hey, listen, that's interesting because my children, they say you are their favorite teacher.
Wow.
Well, Chris, it's offering time. And as the principal of this school, can you tell us what Education Evangelism Ministry is all about?
I was wondering maybe as pastor of the church, you could tell me what Education Evangelism Ministry is all about.
Good answer, good one.
In fact, we're just joking around. We're on the same team.
Yeah, we basically do the same thing, right? What happens in this building is as important as what happens on this building, the school.
Yes, for sure. And we're on the same campus. We feel like we're in the same building, on the same team.
Indeed. My purpose in the church is to make the children disciples of Jesus Christ. And I am certain that throughout the week, that is the aim, that is the purpose of this school, to make children disciples of Jesus Christ.
Yes, absolutely. It's the same mission. Tonight's offering is for education evangelism ministry, where we strive every day to bring children closer to Christ. Thank you in advance for your contribution.
Thank you. To see you high and lifted up. Good evening, brothers and sisters. I'd like to thank the Calgary Central Youth for that rousing song service. And what about our theme song, Make Us One? Very fitting and beautiful song for the times in which we live in, where people are feeling isolated and separated. This evening, our scripture of consideration is Luke chapter 8, verses 22 to 25. You can turn with me in your Bibles if they're in hand or to your devices. Luke chapter 8, verses 22 to 25. I'll be speaking to us this evening from the subject, Let Us Cross Over to the Other Side. The sermon is entitled simply, Let Us Cross Over to the Other Side. I'd like to read in your hearing from the New King James Version. Now it happened on a certain day that he got into a boat with his disciples, and he said to them, Let us cross over to the other side of the lake. And they launched out, but as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the lake, and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and woke him, saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. Then he arose and rebuked the wind and the raging of the wave. And they ceased, and there was a calm. But he said to them, Where is your faith? And they were afraid and marveled, saying to one another, Who can this be? For he commands even the winds and water, and they obey him. Let us pray. The Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me and appointed me to preach the good news of the gospel to the poor and the downtrodden, to set the captives free, to bind up the brokenhearted. Please, Lord, save these words from failure and touch the hearts of the listeners. May they be drawn closer to you. May your name be glorified. In Jesus' name, amen. It was a day of parables, teachings, and healing. And Jesus grew tired at the tsunami of people that came in great waves, filled with eager expectations and high hopes. In the book Desire of Ages, Ellen G. White makes this observation. Day after day, he ministered to them, scarcely pausing for food or rest. And now, the close of the day found him so utterly wearied that he determined to seek retirement in some solitary place across the lake. In verse 22 of chapter 8, Luke is so excited to get to the main part of the narrative that he gets straight to the point in verse 22. He says, now it happened on a certain day that he got into the boat with his disciples. Well, Luke, can you tell us which day that was? No, Luke is not interested in those details. He wants you and I to pay attention to what Jesus is doing. Not so much what Jesus or when Jesus is doing, but what Jesus is doing. The old preacher would say, God may not be there when you want him to be, but he is always on time. The scripture says, now it happened on a certain day that he got into the boat with his disciples, and he said to them, let us cross over to the other side, and they launched out. Part B of this text, let us know that Jesus said to them, now, let us cross over to the other side, and they launched out. So far, so good. Jesus said it, and they did it. It was evening by now, and the sun was casting its last rays of light upon the Middle Eastern sky, setting it ablaze with colors, reds and oranges and hues of purples, and now grew mute with the advancing evening shadows. The stage was set for this simple two-hour scenic journey across familiar waters. These waters they had traversed so many different times. Some of them were master fishermen and had fished these waters and had seen storms before. Jesus, we got this. We got this, Jesus. First of all, we know that you would not send us across a lake and put us in danger or put us in a dangerous situation. Secondly, look at the waves and the waters. It is all calm, pleasant, and placid. Mark would have us know that they took him as he was, which is to say with little concern or preparation, for it was to be a short trip, a brief journey. This journey would be done in a boat that was perhaps originally designed for 12 individuals. Scholars would suggest to us that there was approximately 15 people in the vessel, which may have caused the boat by way of displacement to sink at least 1 foot deeper into the water. If I could pause here parenthetically and hang out here homiletically just for a moment and give a little bit of counsel. We ought to be very careful how many people we let into the boats of our lives, because too many people may have a way of causing our boats to sink deeper than we initially imagined. The boat itself was 27 feet long, 7.5 feet wide, and a maximum preserved height of 4.3 feet was now overcrowded. Clumsily, it made its way across the lake towards the eastern side of the Sea of Galilee, which was less inhabited. And there were towns here and there, yeah, but on that side of the lake, but it was by large desolate, a desolate region when compared to the western side. It contained a population which was more heathen than Jewish and had little communication with Galilee. Thus it offered Jesus the seclusion that he sought, and he now bade his disciples, let us cross over to the other side. However, they're not alone. Mark 4, verse 35 to 41 tells us that there were many other boats which launched out in pursuit of Jesus. Let me say, brothers and sisters, are you worried about filling the pews of your church? Are you worried about adding new members to your congregation? Are you worried about not being able to reach your community? Are you worried about loved ones that are no longer attending church? Let me say this to you, that if Jesus is in the vessel, that Jesus will be the drawing factor. The love of Jesus, the presence of Jesus will woo the sinner back to the cross. Ensure that Jesus is in all that we do as church, as church members. At every potluck, when we're able to get back to potlucks, in every gathering, in every study, in every worship that we do, every devotion, I pray that Jesus will be the center, that he is in the vessel, and he will draw so many to himself. Well, the Bible let us know that there was a sudden storm. The Lake of Galilee is subject to sudden storms, I'll have you know. Situated as it is, some 700 feet below sea level and adjacent to mountainous regions which would ascend heights of close to 2,000 feet, cold air from these heights are apt to sweep down through the precipitous gorges to the east and can cause the wind to whip up a furious storm in no time at all. On this occasion, the boat was being filled with water so that all who sailed were in danger. Not just Jesus' boat, but also the other boats were in danger. He might have gone by land, and it would have been longer, but ultimately safer and less eventful. However, he didn't choose to go by land. He decided to go by way of water, by way of boat, that he might ultimately show his power, his grandeur, and his control over the elements, and that his wonders may be displayed in the deep. Brothers and sisters, as you muse over this message, I posit to you that the critical and the most focal point for me in this message that I'd like to share with you and to focus in on is not the sudden disappearance of the clear night skies, which were alight with millions of stars, that now was shrouded by darkness and the boisterousness of a storm. The focal point of this message, I would say, for this preaching moment, is not the reflective voices of the disciples discussing all of the happenings of the day, the miracles and the teachings that took place. Their voices were now transformed into panicked screams as waters were whipped into maddening waves. No, the focus for this part of the passage is not so much the violent conspiring claws of a wicked storm tossing tiny vessels with wayward winds and waves. No, it is not even the strength of the storm or the calm of the same that followed that presents itself as the most significant point in this pericope. I would say this to you, that what is most significant was that Jesus had entered the boat and advised them, yea, commanded them, let us cross over to the other side. The Bible says, once again, for emphasis, and he said to them, let us cross over to the other side. And they launched out. But as they sailed, he fell asleep. And a windstorm came down on the waves, and they were filling with water and were in jeopardy. And they came to him and awoke him, saying, Master, Master, we are perishing. Brothers and sisters, Jesus is always woke. He's always on top of things. He's always relevant. He's always recent. He always knows what's happening. He was never taken off guard. Heaven has no crisis. There are no emergency, no great flashing lights that takes heaven unawares. There's always provisions for you and I in the midst of the storm. The disciples may have felt forsaken or alone as a result of Jesus falling asleep in the stern of the ship, and he was further obscured by the darkness. They tried without success to gain control over their sinking vessel. Surely they forgot that a slumbering Savior in a storm-tossed boat is better than calm waters without one. They must have abandoned all notions of doing things alone as they sought the help of Jesus. You know how it is with us. We like to figure things out. We like to work out the details ourselves. We like to be in control of our situations, even when it's spiraling out of control. We'd like to think that we have our hands on it. But the more we try to fix things sometimes, the worse it becomes. And things tend to get out of control. And we feel like our vessels are sinking. That's the time that we ought to pray, that we ought to cry out to Jesus. That's the time that we ought to let go and allow God to come in. And with his caring ways and his comforting words and his powerful presence can make a difference in our lives and change those circumstances so that we can be successful and be drawn closer to him. I'd like to say that there are some benefits to being alone. But there's perhaps more to be said that there are more benefits to working together and being a part of a larger group. It is quite true that spending time alone can help one to reflect, to focus, to plan, strategize, grow, and develop without the intrusion and distraction of other things or other people. However, as humans, we are designed to be social beings. For God said it best in the book of Genesis at the creation of Adam that it was not good for man to be alone. It is most fascinating that even in the animal kingdom, animals in seeking comfort and protection of their own kind will gather together because they know that there is strength in unity. The group is better because they can get together. When the group is big enough, the size of the individual does not matter. I'll say that again. When the group is of size or big enough, the size of the individual does not matter because they benefit from the strength of the group. When bees come together, we call them a swarm. Buffaloes, when they come together, we call them a gang. Camels, a caravan. Dogs, a pack. Eagles, when they get together, are called a convocation. Elephants are called a parade. Fish are called a school. And lions, a pride. Owls, when they come together, are called a parliament. And I got one here for you. A group of alligators, when they come together, when alligators come together, they're called a congregation. Well, an Ethiopian proverb gives us these words of wisdom. When spiders unite, they can tie down the strongest of lions. I posit to you that a flock of sparrows working together can thwart the advance of a hungry eagle. I'd like to encourage each and every one of us as members of this great church that you are not alone and that it is better actually to work together, to help each other, to support each other. In all that we go through, we can make it if we work together. We're better than even the groupings of the animals. So let the fish school and the wolves have their packs. But when I go through some difficult moments, when I face a problem in my life, I want to go to the brethren to give me encouragement. I want to have somebody in the church pray for me, to lift me up before the throne of God, to tell me it's going to be all right, that God has got this, and I'm going to make it. Children of God, my brothers and sisters, it has been a devastatingly cruel year and a half of COVID-19 pandemic. We have seen all of humanity impacted by the jaws, claws, and paws of this deadly virus. My heart goes out and prayers also to the families who have been devastated and touched by this pandemic, whether through death or irreparable physical and mental devastation. We have seen tough times that has depleted our resources, stretched our faith, challenged our understanding, exhausted our patience, and tested our resolve to deal with the world that is quickly changing and has changed. So many in having their faith challenged and stretched are asking today, where is God in all of this madness, in all of this chaos? Where is He as the storms in their lives ensue and are left unabated? Our church and its members here in the Alberta Conference have not been left untouched. I know that at present there is a no-mask mandate and the determination to return to normalcy. There are deep and abiding scars that we must navigate together, and we can do this through prayer and communal support. We are not alone. We will work together as members. We will work together as children of God to make our moments of despair into brighter moments of hope. However, even in these challenging and stormy times, let us never lose sight of the fact that Jesus is still in the vessel. There are times when it may appear that He is asleep. It seems reasonable at that time to try to take matters into your own hands. Just remember, you're not alone. You're not alone. Before we started this journey, He got into our boats. And He has told us as a church, let us cross over to the other side. This pandemic is not the final chapter. This pandemic cannot hold the children of God back. That He is stronger than this virus. That there is hope for all of us to make it to the other side. We just have to keep on trusting. Consider the manner of the command. Let us cross over to the other side. It is an invitation that is twofold: to work together as we row the boat in the storm, and the second part, while keeping an eye on the storm, let us not lose sight of the Savior. The truth is, we are stronger together than apart. We must learn to live together, Martin Luther King would say. We must learn to live together as brothers or perish together as fools. None of us, Ken Blanchard would say, none of us is as strong and smart as all of us. There is strength in unity. Right now, I'd like for you to believe afresh that there's hope. Right now, I'd like for you to believe and know and understand that your marriages are not failures, that there's hope. Right now, that even though you might be unemployed at this moment, perhaps laid off or your business has dissolved or some catastrophic financial moment in your life, that he who owns all the cattle upon 1,000 hills, the silver and gold, can restore your finances, can bless you again, bless you afresh, and restore what you have lost. Right now, we must understand that our God, who has entered our vessel, entered our lives a long time ago, we've been walking with God a mighty long time. Some of us, older now, eyes weary and worn, and we have seen a lot, but God has not failed us. Those of us that are young or younger, those that are younger, can claim Jesus for yourself, that he walks with you through your personal trials, through your challenges, that he understands you, that he speaks your language, that he knows what you're going through. And everybody in between, our God is a personable God that can help us all in our greatest storms. Notice the contrast here. Christ, while physically sleeping, was spiritually aware. The disciples, though physically awake, were spiritually asleep. The question is asked, where is thy faith? Where is thy faith? The passage goes on to say, then he arose and rebuked the winds and the raging of the waters, and they ceased, and there was calm. But he said to them, where is your faith? And they were afraid and marveled, saying one to another, who can this be? For he commands even the winds and the waters, and they obey him. Imagine with me as you will. Indulge in your sanctified imagination for a moment. Jesus entering the vessel with his disciples. He beckons to them, go over to the other side. And while they pushed out and launched into the deep to traverse this placid and pleasant evening on the water, no waves, nothing disruptive, he goes to the stern and falls asleep and is fast asleep, head laying perhaps on a pillow, comfortably. Then all of a sudden a storm ensues and the disciples are straining at the oar, trying to make it, trying to work things out, trying to right that which is wrong, trying to work through what is wrong and trying to make it right. It almost sounds like where some of us are, where we're trying to do righteousness by works. We're trying to save ourselves. But in truth, when we believe and understand that Jesus is the Savior and the Savior alone of our lives, that our works cannot save us, no matter how much we strain at the oars, we must turn our attention and our prayers and our devotion and our lives over to Jesus. Human effort cannot save us. Human wisdom cannot save us. Human stratagem cannot save us. We must trust in Christ, even if we think he is asleep and does not evidence anything in our lives to say that our prayers have been answered. Keep on praying. If it seems that a solution is slow to come, keep on hoping, because he is a restorer. He is a strength, and he's a power within himself that he will touch our lives and change our circumstances. I believe that. And I know that you can have that change even today. Watch him as the disciples scream at the top of their lungs, "Master, Master, we are perishing. Carest not that we are sinking, that we are perishing?" They're panicked at this point in time. Their vision is obscured by the darkness of the evening. The storm is at full tilt. The wind is blowing. Lightning is flashing. The waves are pounding against the boat. They're in great peril. Perhaps this is how you feel with how your life is, spinning out of control. But I want you to understand that you are not forsaken. Jesus is on board. He's in your life. He has an interest in you. That even when you let go, he still holds on to you. He may seem like he's asleep, but he's wide awake. And he's watching, looking for your faith. Ah. In their darkest and most dismal moment, watch what happens. The spirit of prophecy would let us know, Ellen G. White lets us know in The Desire of Ages, that he was obscured by the storm and could not hear their desperate cries because of the howling of the winds. And the fact that they could not see him made them even more desperate. And surely the person who is lost in sin grows more desperate when they cannot see Jesus. My brothers and sisters, do not spend a moment in sin. It separates you from God and causes great darkness to come about us. Instead, keep on praying. Keep on crying out. Let's work together. Keep on straining at the oars, because those that are busy rowing the boat don't have time to rock the boat with issues and problems. Notice, if you will, Jesus, hearing, stands up as a man and speaks up as a God in the midst of a boat that is shifting and shaking and moving about, being tossed about by the wave. Jesus, with impeccable balance, stands up in the middle of the ship and we would hear in the writings of Desire of Ages, Ellen G. White mentions, that when the lightning flashes, they see the peace of his countenance. They see the grandeur and splendor of his divinity. Oh, how amazing that is. To know that in our darkest, most desperate time, Jesus is standing for us, to represent us, to keep us, to help us, to elevate us, to give us hope. When he stands, he speaks, and the madness and chaos has to listen, because their creator is speaking. Nature must respond. And he rebukes the wind, and the wind, with its aggressive attitude and loud voice, became but a whisper and died down. The waves that were boisterous and pounding the ship became like lapdogs at the feet of Jesus. The lightning that flashed with so much arrogance was calmed and shamed by the more glorious countenance of Christ. Blushing at the countenance of Jesus, it scampered back and wrapped itself into darkness and would not show itself. And the thunder that drummed like some army in the distance became mute and scampered back into the hills. Jesus has spoken peace. Jesus has called calm into existence and have asked and commanded the storm to be still. What kind of man is this? He is your Savior. He is your power. He is your help. In conclusion, I want you to understand that there is purpose as to why he said to them, "Let's cross over to the other side." Why that command meant that they could not fail. because Jesus said it. And he says the same thing to each and every one of us. You see, there was a purpose for him to get over to the other side. There was someone, there were men that were in the tombs that were possessed by demons. There were many lives to be touched on the other side, on the eastern side of Galilee. If they had not crossed over to the other side, the demoniac would never be delivered. If they had not crossed over to the other side, the woman with the issue of blood would never be healed. She would still be bleeding. If they had not crossed over to the other side, Jairus' daughter would have remained dead and without hope. If they had not crossed over to the other side, two blind men in Capernaum would not have received their sight. Should they not have crossed over to the other side, 500 men plus women and children, approximately over 20,000 people would not have been fed with a few fish and a few pieces of bread. If they had not crossed over to the other side, the young boy with an unclean spirit would still be possessed. The mute would not speak. The lame would not walk. The lepers would not be healed. Lazarus would not be raised from the dead if they had not crossed over to the other side. Thank God that they crossed over to the other side, that they worked together, that they trusted the Lord. And we too, each and every one of us, as children of God and part of this great family, can and will cross over to the other side. For the God whom we serve is a storm stiller. I've heard somebody say that he is a light in the midst of darkness, that he is a bridge over troubled water, that he is the bright and morning star, that he is the savior of all humankind, the great counselor, the wonderful counselor, the mighty God. This Jesus can help us. He's a strength to the weary. He's hope to those that are devastated and downtrodden. This Jesus beckons to us to cross over to the other side. May God bless you as you trust in him and we go forward together. I'd like to invite you at this time to bow your heads in prayer. And I pray that your hearts have been touched or warmed in some way, even through the foolishness of preaching, even my preaching. I humbly ask that you please trust God. And as we pray, claim for yourself that you are a child of God and Jesus died for you. And there's still hope despite all the storms. That he who spake calm so many years ago can still speak calm and peace today in your life. Let us be diligent in dealing with what is before us, unless we find ourselves unprepared for what is ahead. God bless you. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you in the name of your Son, Jesus. We thank you so much for your love and for your matchless mercy. Thank you for the journey. Thank you for the invitation. Continue to help us to understand that we're stronger together. We are stronger together than apart. As long as you're with us, we could rise to any challenge, overcome any foe, and we can indeed be triumphant in our lives. Please hear our prayers and give us strength and faith. For we ask this in the name of Jesus the Christ. Amen.